Good morning. About 3 years ago, the City Council decided to do these work sessions on Saturday morning before the public hearing. And they worked out very well. We've been able to have all the departments come in and present their budgets to the City Council members, and so that they can ask their questions before the public hearing and make some comments, so that we're prepared a better way to present to the public. Also, one of the things that we heard from the public a few years ago was that we'd spend an hour or so on the presentations before the public hearing. And people have other things they need to do. They wanted to come in and talk about the budget. And they got a little frustrated with us making our presentations, which I believe we needed to do. But we thought, and the council thought, it was a better way to do it on Saturday, have it all day, have it recorded. We will publicize that it is available, keep rerunning it. People can watch it on YouTube. And then when they come to the public hearing on next Wednesday night, they'll have a background if they want, or I'll be giving a summary of what pretty much you'll see today. So the first thing, just from a housekeeping perspective, we do have the budget work session for today. We're starting out with a presentation where I'll give a synopsis of the budget, and you can see the different departments that will be coming in. Hopefully, we will adjourn by 2:30. One change to this agenda is that after I make my presentation, I'd like to have Judy Belanger do hers for her department. She has to attend the funeral today, so I will indulge from your perspective that we'll have that, and it should be about a 10 or 15 minute presentation. But this is the agenda for the day, and you all have a copy of it. And you can see the schedule of dates for the rest of the council deliberation on the budget. Of course, the council can add dates if it wishes. Wednesday at 6:30, just note the time, 6:30 p.m. We will have a public hearing on the FY17 budget in the council chambers. This is really a city council meeting in which one item takes place. It's to receive input from the public on the fiscal 17 budget. This is in accordance with the charter. Then on the Wednesday, May 18th, the City Council will have a work session on the water and sewer. Typically, we had that together with the overall budget hearing, but the council again wanted that separated out because of the different projects that were going on, especially in the sewer department. And so we have a work session on that, which really is an opportunity for the council to dive into the water and sewer budget a little bit deeper. And on the 23rd, the City Council will have a work session. It'll be a budget review from things that you may have wanted to talk more about and give and ask for information back. At that work session, what we'll do is we'll work with you to the newer council members to go through the process for the adoption of the budget that we hope to have on June 6th. And what that entails is going through all the resolutions that we have to adopt, because technically this budget is an ordinance, and this really gives the legal authority for us to go forward and spend for fiscal year 17, which is July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2017. So with that, I'll talk a little bit about the budget itself. We've had the budget award from the Government Finance Officers Association for the last 10 years. We were the only one to have this in all of New Hampshire out of the 234 municipalities. This year, Concord got theirs, so we're one of two. But I still think that it's a great document, because there are the presentation, the way we put it together, is anybody can take a look at our budget and know a tremendous amount about the city, not only just the numbers, but the projects that we're working on, the goals that we have, and how to read the document. If you recall, the City Council reinstated the Joint Budget Committee. The Joint Budget Committee met twice in December. The Finance Department provided some preliminary numbers to the Joint Budget Committee. The Joint Budget Committee did recommend to the City Council that there be no more than a 3% increase in the operating budget. And then on January 25th, 2016, the City Council voted to ask me to bring forward a budget with a 3% increase in operating, and also to provide some budgeting separately for collective bargaining and contingency. So for those that you have not reviewed the budget before, major portion of our budget is operating, 78%, and non-operating represents 22%. You can see that we did achieve the goal of the 3% in the operating budget. The non-operating, which I'll talk about a little bit later, is going up 3.96, but the overall budget's going up about 3.2% over last year. Long-term financial planning, some of the reasons we're able to keep a stable and predictable budget and tax rate is that we have the use of unassigned fund balance ordinance, leave it termination stabilization fund, health insurance stabilization fund, debt service planning policy, capital improvement plan, and the rolling stock replacement plan, all of which I'll refer to as I get to those slides. Here you are with the operating budget and the breakdown. Key factors in the operating budget are typically salaries, retirement costs, workers' compensation, health insurance premiums. And you can see that the largest part of our operating budget is in the schools, about 55%, fire 10%, police 12%, general government 22%, and that amount of money that I set aside for collective bargaining, 1%. Overall, you can see on the chart what the dollars are for each of those departments, and you can see that we have come to a 3% increase total. In keeping with the council, and I know there are a few council members that were very interested in making sure that we didn't have one size fits all, we did have the overall goal of 3%, but we worked with the police department. They came in a little bit higher than the 3% because Chief Mera had some ideas, as he will explain later, regarding the reorganization of the department and part of the accreditation program that he wants to put in place. Then, of course, you see the collective bargaining that's there. That is money that will be set aside for the 8 collective bargaining agreements that we have not negotiated settlements on. One of the things about the operating budget, because we are a labor-intensive organization, 83% of the operating budget is for salary and benefits. Only 17% is discretionary in other areas. You can see how that breaks down among the departments. General government, you can see, was 22% of the entire budget, but is only 15% from a salary and benefits. That's because the Public Works has a lot more materials and things that they use throughout the year for their construction projects. Here we have the list of the collective bargaining agreements. Those that are not shaded have been negotiated. In the budget, you'll find that the COLAs are in those budgets. The ones that are in blue are the have not been negotiated as of yet, and either have expired or will expire on June 30th. One thing about that is that you have to remember that within these budgets, we still allow for what we call step increases. Step increases are those increases in a person's pay based on their longevity when they come into the organization as a new employee. And again, due to the uncertainty of the negotiated salaries, again, you can see that we've set aside the $432,000 in the budget. If we did not have that in the budget, what we typically would have to do before we approved any of the collective bargaining agreements is we'd have to fund it through an appropriation from unassigned fund balance. And of course, that would take a public hearing and a vote of the City Council. Then you'd be able to act on the collective bargaining agreement. Retirement rates. The retirement rates are set on a biennium basis. This year, the percentages are still staying the same as fiscal 16, but you can see what we pay for every dollar. We put in 11 cents for general government employees or 15 cents for teachers. For every dollar of payroll, we put in about 26 cents for police and 29 cents for fire department. And you can see the increases, and again, these are as a result of either COLA and step increases, and you can see the increase in pension. And we are paying a total of about $7.1 million to the state for our pension costs. This year, for the first time in our CAFR, our audit, we did set aside a number that showed the unfunded liability. The next area is health insurance, and you can see over the last 10 years, we've had health insurance, and you can see how it goes up and down every year. And then back about 12 or 14 years ago, we set aside that stabilization fund. And what we do is we take the 10-year average, and that's what we budget every year. So the 10-year average is 4.7%, and you can see what we set aside. In order to reach that, we also will use about $804,000 from the stabilization fund. Stabilization fund, excuse me, has about $7 million in it at this point. Workers' compensation is based on our experience, and each category, police officer, firefighter, teacher, have a certain code that they have under state law, and that's a factor that we use in the formula to determine how much we have to pay. It's typically, at the end of the year, there's an audit done, and what happens is you use the rating of each profession, and you multiply it by our experience factor, and that's how you get to our increase or our decrease. We are now at an experience factor of about 97%. It's good if it's below 100%. Once you go over 100%, not good. One of the things that we did this year is the police department, we were working with them for a few years, and they were not utilizing some of the best practices for workers' compensation, such as light duty. But Chief Mara has instituted a lot of changes, and we have already seen some results on that. So that's why we actually put their actual number. Before, we would break it up based on our experience rating, and our experience rating would have been for the whole community of police, fire, schools, and general government, and that's 0.97. But this way, I think with Chief Mara working on it, we're getting some better results. The utility costs, Marketplace has allowed us to reduce some of our utility costs this year. It's the second year that we've gone directly to a third-party vendor and have bid our electricity, and we had some good results in that, and Peter Rice will talk about that a little later when he's presenting his public works budget. The non-operating, there are four areas in non-operating that really affect us and have two of which is we really can't reduce. The first one is Rockingham County. Rockingham County is a large part of our fixed costs over in the non-operating. Also debt service, which you can see is 55% of the non-operating. Then we have rolling stock in our capital outlay. One thing I wanted to point out to you is an interesting chart that Judy put together. It shows that we're the highest community in Rockingham County in terms of what we pay in taxes, but only the fourth populous. And so you can see that over the course of time, we paid a lot more percentage than other communities. While the budget increased by 21% throughout the years from 08 forward to 17, the city of Portsmouth's obligation went up 47%. This year, we're obligated to pay $5.3 million to the county. Capital outlay, you can see that over the years, we've set aside the amount of money for capital outlay that does not include our debt service and rolling stock, but there are other projects. The planning board set aside a goal of 2% of the prior year's budget for the amount that should be set aside for capital, and it seems to have worked out pretty well. It keeps us on task when it comes to making sure that we the value of money as we go forward can buy what we need to buy for and replace various projects that we have been doing. So you can see that the CIP has last year did stay at about 1.7, and this year hopefully we'll be able to stay at about $2 million. This is a list of the capital items, and we'll be going through those at a later time. This is the rolling stock replacement. You can see in your budget that we have an appendix that shows every piece of equipment that the city owns and when the date is for replacement. You notice that the fire department, the police have an extra Explorer in here. Last year, we asked them to reduce one, and so we're trying to get on the schedule again, and that's why they have those in there, the extra one. We used to have the Crown Victorias. The cost of the Explorers are a lot higher, but and I believe the chief can talk to this, but I think they're more durable and more functional than the Crown Vic. Net debt service, we have a policy that the city council has put in place, which I think is good, so that we pay attention to what we're putting aside for debt service. We have a policy that no more than 10% of our budget should be for repayment of principal and interest for debt service. And you can see that we have stayed below that number. In your budget itself, this number was 8.66, and we have a replacement page if you like it, but it's we did the correction of it should be 8.59. The reason is that we didn't include the mid-year amount of money that was put aside for the
supplemental appropriation
for the middle school. Yes, thank you. And so that's just a slight correction there. And you can see the difference between the schools and the general government is what is set aside. And over here, building aid, and again, the council that did move forward in the middle school should be commended, because we were the last, I think one of the last, to get some building aid in the state. So this is what we get every year. We use our debt service reserve, so it helps offset this number. The tax rate, which everybody is very interested in, is based on our revenues and expenditures. We're able to come in with a 31-cent tax increase. If you look at the new median single family, that means that's about a 1.8% increase, or about $8.93 a month, or $107 a year. Going forward, if you look at Portsmouth and how we stack up against other communities of our size, these are communities of 20,000 or more, using a lot of the equalized tax rate, which is really an apples-to-apples type of review. The city of Portsmouth is the lowest in the state with communities over 20,000. You can see this chart where Keene, out of the group, is the highest, and Portsmouth is the lowest. Just going back here, basically out of the 234 municipalities, and I do mention this in my budget message, I think we're 42nd, Judy, in terms
42nd
in terms of overall from the state. This is another chart, and probably we'll drop this off next year because we keep saying it, but I think it's important to remember, the state has eliminated the retirement revenue that they used to pay for police, fire, and teachers. And over the years since they've eliminated, that's $10.4 million that we no longer have. The other thing is the state continues to regulate retirement with not putting any money into it. This year alone, we are, if you can see that, if we would have been getting the regular formula that they had in place prior to fiscal year 2010, we'd be getting another $2 million, or about 50 cents on the tax rate. So these downshifts really do cost, they're not keeping taxes low. They are at the state level, but they're pushing everything down to the local level in the overuse of the property tax. Here we have the use of fund balance. We have committed fund balance and unassigned fund balance. As you can see, there's a reason that we use a fund balance, and that is this year, in the middle of the year, we needed to work with the JBC, the Joint Building Committee, on the middle school to finish the project. And so what will happen is it's hopeful that they'll recover most of this from their work with, I don't want to say litigation, but the ability to recover from the contractor and the architect and all those that were involved. But this hopefully will come back, and then we'll go into our fund balance when it does come back. And the history of unassigned fund balance, you can see that we are at about 12.7% And this is, in showing the correlation to what that does for us, not only because we have a stable and predictable tax rate and we have a good unassigned fund balance, we can see over the last number of years that we've had 5 increases in our bond rating to the top rating of AAA. We're one of 2 communities in New Hampshire that have a AAA rating. And that does help us when we go into the marketplace to sell bonds. And also sometimes you'll see those premiums that come in. We're very desirable for portfolios, so that's why we get the premiums. One thing that people talk about a lot is the parking garages and how much they cost the city and the citizens. Just trying to correct that misinformation is the general fund receives $2.4 million from parking, or 39% of parking revenue. Without this, the tax rate would be 51 cents higher. So it would be 51 cents higher without the parking revenues in our general fund revenue. Our revenues, of course, again, 77% are from the property taxes, and you can see these other areas that we do receive revenue as well. So at this time, what I'd like to do, unless there are any questions.
Yes. Is this time to ask questions now?
Or? Yeah, if you can, yeah, after each presentation, yeah.
Okay. I have a question about the collective bargaining contingency.
Sure.
We had, I think you showed that there were some contracts that are due to expire this June,
mm-hmm.
and there are other contracts that expired 2 years ago.
Right.
Right. Last year, for FY16, we budgeted $312,000 for a collective bargaining contingency. Mm-hmm. And hypothetically, if none of those contracts get settled, that rolls over into the unassigned or the...
It would be an operating surplus.
Operating surplus, right? I guess this is a discussion, and I don't feel strongly either way, but I just wanted to raise the point is that when you have not the 2016 ones that are going to expire, I think we should have those in a contingency format, but when you have the ones that have been expired for a while and we keep having the contingency that then goes into the unassigned
one thing
that rolls over,
right.
That you'd say, you know what, at some point we could just not fund them. I agree we need a vote then to take it out of the pile of money and move it into that department, but I would be okay with that because we would have been doing that for the past couple years.
Just remember,
yeah.
You have had a policy to not have retroactivity. So,
and that's right. So I'm assuming we wouldn't have retroactivity.
Right.
This is predicated on that.
Right. Yeah. So what would happen is you no longer need that money because you're not paying those wages.
Well, that wage I'm assuming would be to cover the COLA within that fiscal year.
Right. So these are here for So if in fiscal year 16 they don't settle their contract, if the council keeps with its policy of no retroactivity, you have no obligation to pay or retroactivity, so that money that's been set aside no longer is needed.
Right.
That's my point, I'm wondering.
I guess I'm missing it.
We don't need to budget that full amount. I'm thinking maybe we could, for contingency purposes, budget for the 2016 expiring contracts, but the other ones have already been kind of paid for. And Chris can.
Well, I believe last year, that's why we reduced it to 312 for that logic, and so I think we might consider that for this year as well, because I don't think we need as much.
Right.
I would agree with that.
Yeah, so I guess what we could do is, you know, when we get into the work session where you want more reduction, we'll come up with some numbers, but Judy, you can speak.
The original budget was about $490,000 in FY16. We had a couple contracts, I think 1386B, was that the only contract? And a couple of the schools contracts that were settled throughout the year. So we reallocate the money that's in that appropriation line item to the individual departments, bringing it down to 312. But again, that could.
Yeah, because we can talk about that. But yeah, this year, fiscal 17, I believe we're putting 432 aside. So what that $432,000. So the council has, we can come up with an analysis as to if that can be reduced or not. Do we have an anticipation that? And the worst that can happen is, you know, that money is going to go in the fund balance, actually reduce the tax rate a little bit lower because every penny is $47,000. So however you want to reduce it, If we don't use it in that fiscal year, again, it goes as a operating surplus and then flows into fund balance, unassigned fund balance. So 6 and 1/2 and those are the other, you know.
This is perhaps a Judy question. The amount that's represented there isn't actually the amount anyway.
No, and it's actually, it was a higher amount during the JBC preliminary numbers. We actually reduced it a little bit for that same reason that we're not going to probably have contracts exactly on July 1.
Okay.
So, and you know, it is an estimate. It's just basically based off a COLA, so if there's anything else that was negotiated in the contracts themselves, wouldn't be covered in that number.
And like we have done in the past, especially with the fire department, because it has, they had been outstanding for a number of years, if you recall, we took it from fund balance. So you can still do that.
I mean,
it's, and it makes it, quite frankly, there's two sides to that. You know, one is that it has a full review in terms of before you can adopt the contract, you need to adopt the funding for that contract, and there'll be a public hearing on it. So there's two sides to that. So anyways, any other questions?
We had a question from Jim, then Josh.
John, just so that we all understand, because all of us were criticized, certainly when we voted in favor of the, by a number of people, when we voted in favor of the new parking garage. Deer Ridge Parking Center, and there's always been a lot of confusion. You addressed it briefly about how we benefit or not from additional parking and the garages and the meters. And certainly Joey Giordano and Peter Rice got into this with the Citywide Neighborhood Committee meeting this past Tuesday, a nice discussion we had. But do you mean that after, I mean, there's expenses of snow removal, there's expenses of maintenance, there's expenses of enforcement, there's expenses certainly of the building. Do you mean that after all of that is paid for, that we actually in Portsmouth benefit to the point of, to the number of $2.4 million currently from our parking a fund?
Right.
And that does reduce the tax rate for an average home by what?
51 cents, which would be probably $150 a year. About that.
So that is the fact that parking pays for itself, and plus we benefit from it.
So this right here, this number here, the $3.7 million, is what's in the parking budget. The revenues, of course, are $6.1 million, and anything additional goes into general fund. What I'm trying to do is hold it to the $2.4 million so that we don't lose ground, and maybe, because I'm starting to set some money aside for when debt service hits for the new garage. So we're putting a little bit aside so that we don't have it spike in 1 year and we don't lose the revenue on the general fund side. So the idea is we're setting money aside, and then we also have the part of the equation will be raising the rates on the street again, and to a point that had been estimated. So when the garage does open, we'll make that adjustment. That'll be in another 2 years or so. So yes, Assistant Mayor, this blue is what goes into the general fund. And the other thing about the parking transportation is a lot of money for a lot of the snow removal, the downtown loadout. As you may be aware, whenever we load out the downtown, it's about $50,000. Some of that comes out of the parking transportation. Also, the downtown beat police officers, we put $80,000 in that to help out with having a downtown beat officer. So, real money, $2.4 million in the shuttle.
In the shuttle.
Shuttle comes out of $3.7 million, too. And the senior transportation and Coast, all that comes out of this number, which is not part of the tax rate.
And there is also a resident discount.
Yes.
And despite all, in addition to all of that, we helped solve the parking problem.
Correct. So so when you talk to people, you can explain that all the things, senior transportation, Coast, downtown cleanup, downtown snow removal, all that, the beat police officer downtown comes out of this, and then there's left over $2.4 million or about 51 cents on the tax rate.
Thank you. Interesting.
Okay. Joshua, you had a question?
I did. I think it would be benefit for myself and I imagine a number of residents to maybe explain a little bit more about the equalized tax rate when comparing to other towns.
Sure.
I think it would be easy for someone to get confused between that tax rate and our actual tax rate. Understand how that formula works or how we're comparing apples to apples.
Sure, absolutely. I'll ask the assessor to explain it. She'll do it a lot better than I could.
So there's two tax rates. One's the actual tax rate, and that's based on the percentage of market value within the community. And then you have the equalized tax rate that's set by the state of New Hampshire. And what they do is they take all the communities, and then they adjust that tax rate based on 100% of market value. So in other words, if the city of Portsmouth was at 90% of market value, the tax rate would be adjusted down 10% by the state.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, Ruth. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, I'll turn it over to Judy.
Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning. I do appreciate the opportunity to talk about the finance department and kind of mess up the agenda on you a little bit, but I'll be brief. The finance department budget begins on page 161 with the organizational chart. We have the service overviews is the tax and revenue collection. I have with me today Becky Benvenuti, our revenue administrator. Assessing, we have Roseanne Lentz, the assessor. Information technology, I have Alan Brady here today, who's in charge of information technology. We also have purchasing, benefit and payroll administration, and the accounting department. The finance department proposed budget is a little over $2 million. There's 20 full-time employees and two part-time, and this is an increase of about 2.48%. This is just an illustration with the finance department that we are involved in all of the departments within the city of Portsmouth, including the school. As you may know, the city of Portsmouth, the school department is a dependent department, unlike some of the other municipalities or most of the municipalities in the state of New Hampshire, where they're more independent. They have their own balance sheet, they handle their own cash. The finance department has all the city side has all of the cash and all the reconciliations on the school as well. But we deal with the trustees of trust funds, all the special revenue funds, and all of the financial statements in accordance with the departments. A couple of new initiatives with the finance department this year is in the last couple of years of our annual audit, our external auditors had talked about the trustees of trust funds for Prescott Park. They were off-site. They basically had two part-time people doing the bookkeeping and the treasuring. And they are a part of our financial statements, so the auditors had recommended that we kind of consolidate the trustees of trust funds within the finance department. So in this past year, we physically moved the two individuals who do the bookkeeping and the treasury function over to City Hall, and then over this next year, we'll be transitioning to do all of the financing part within the finance department. Another new initiative is that we have a new benefits administration position that's added to the finance department. We're kind of creating a benefit administration payroll function within the finance, going with along with number three. What we're going to be doing this year is moving the payroll individual from the school department down to the finance department so that we'll have two payroll coordinators and a benefit administrator who will be all kind of working together.
Right. And I just want to mention on the benefit administration, there's no additional position. It's a reallocation of resources from another department.
So. Right. We just thought that we kind of all work together well with the benefit administrator kind of overseeing the payroll functions as well. Now, we talked over the several years, we talked about the payroll function and kind of reducing staff in order to prepare the payroll for both city and school, but the problem with that is that their payroll is on an off week between the school and the city, so that individual would never be able to have a vacation if we only had one person. But the other piece of that puzzle is that the school department by state is under a different database. They have a whole different account structure, so we can't run the payroll altogether. So it's two individual functions.
One of the other things I want to mention is that this gives us backup in the payroll area if somebody's sick or is on vacation.
Absolutely.
The second thing is that with the ACA, the Affordable Care Act, and I want to commend Diana for her patience and perseverance in getting out to, what are they, 1035s now? 1095s, the new form that you have to get out for your health insurance. We need to, you know, unfortunately, the ACA has caused all kinds of new paperwork, especially when you have 900, you know, employees plus part-time, and she's done a great job with that. But we wanted to put this, we wanted to try to consolidate this, because as we go forward, the ACA is not going to get easier, it's going to get harder. So it's going to be a lot more reporting, so.
That's okay. So some of the additional finance department responsibilities, we have the tax and revenue collection, which is the collection of all property taxes. We have about a 98% collection rate. Becky Benvenuti works very, very closely with our taxpayers and reaching out to them and helping them with payment arrangements or whatever programs that we can offer them to help them and to assist them. The tax collection office also processes the tax liens and the tax deeds. We have a very low, about 1% on tax liens within Portsmouth, which is a really good indicator, a good economic indicator for Portsmouth. And we haven't deeded properties in several years, so that's also a good indicator there. I do collections of all water sewer payments. The tax office is also the municipal agent for the state of New Hampshire, so that we're able to do motor vehicle registrations. We offer boat registrations, and I think this past year we added the ATVs and snowmobile registrations, which is, it's not a big moneymaker, but it's a really added convenience to the citizens. And we do all central collections for all of the departments, whether it's recreation or the school, that all of the deposits are prepared in the tax office. In the assessing office, we do the annual assessments of all the city properties, must be compliant with the New Hampshire state statutes and assessing standard boards. We process the exemptions and credits for elderly, disabled, and blind exemptions, the veteran credits, and solar exemptions. In the information technology, Ellen is the coordinator for the whole city website and handles all the Channel 22 programs. We have a number of hardware and software, a number of 19 servers, so it handles the whole city except for the school. The school is under their separate server. But we also contract out with Seacoast Computers so that we are offered 24/7 technical support, which is real important because we have fire and police and operations that run 24/7. We also handle purchasing, benefit and payroll administration, which I already spoke about, and then our accounting functions for accounts payable, central billing, we do the fire alarms, police outside detail, water sewer billing, and then general ledger and bank reconciliations.
One thing I want to mention, on the Channel 22, I think it's interesting, there have been more requests for us to the video, and we did in March, I think, Alan, 20 meetings. So most meetings now you'll be able to see on YouTube and go back. So, and we're also working on, as requested by the City Council, a way to archive anything prior to 2012. We're trying to figure out because it was a different format. So, but again, that's something I think people have commented on and really like the idea of being able to go and look at those.
Some of the additional functions within the finance department, we're also the treasury functions, the oversight of all the revenue collection and expenditures and all cash management. Responsible for the tax rate setting, there are 15 municipal reports that need to be filed with the state in coordination with the assessor's office, the school, and the city side in order to set that tax rate in October. We're responsible for all the bond issuances, preparing for the bond rating, preparing the official statement, which is actually the bid document for bonds, and the continuing disclosure annual report. We prepare the annual audits. We have the annual financial statements. We have a single audit because we receive so many federal grants. It's a separate audit that's prepared. And then we monitor and do some internal control audits throughout the city. We prepare the capital improvement plan, the comprehensive financial report, or the CAFRA, which is submitted to you in about January of each year, and then this preparation of this annual budget document. One thing I wanted to say about this document, and I hope that you have an opportunity to kind of really go through it, it does meet the GFOA requirements and mandatory requirements to receive the award, but we have so much more information in this book that's outside of the required information that is suggested by GFOA. There's a great citywide recognitions and accomplishment sections and community economic profile, and so there's just a lot of information.
A lot of departments have put the information in, but it's the finance department that has to put it all together, and Judy Stapp and herself have done a great job putting this together.
This right here is also in the budget document. It's on page 87, and what this just kind of illustrates is all of the funds that we're responsible for within the finance department. There's over $150 million of cash flow on an annual basis. This demonstrates that there's five shaded boxes, and those are the budgets that are in this document. Outside of the shaded are all the other funds that we have reconciliations and the financial statements associated with them. So just briefly, some highlights here. We have about 8,500 assessed properties or taxable properties within the city. Of the 8,500 count, about 17% of that count makes up the commercial base. But as far as the total assessment and the assessed value, the commercial makes up 47%. So it's almost 50% of that responsibility of the taxes that's on the commercial side. After the revaluation last year, this is like a 3% swing. So the commercial side has picked up about an additional 3% more of the total assessed value within the city. Some of the indicators here is telling us that we are making some, the economy is definitely coming back. If you look at the number of building permits here, where we've been over the last several years, and then all of a sudden here we have this jump up of over 3,000 building permits. All of these building permits are recorded in the assessor's office, and then there's a determination of how many, I think what about 60% or 70% that you have to actually go out to the individual properties to record those permits. And as you can see up here, this is just an indicator of how the economy is also coming back with sales. We see that big dip down here about 2010, and so we've gone through about 300 sales, and we're, as you can see, climbing back up. Here was the peak back in 2006, so we're climbing back up to that peak area there. Tax revenue, the auto registration is one of our largest revenue sources. Again, it just shows the economy is coming back. You can see that dip on the number of automobile registrations coming back up to 2015, about 2,300 registrations annually. But if you see the revenue, we had a dip below $3 million, and that's actually anticipated about $3.8 million in revenue moving forward. The city's website users pretty much has kind of stayed the same, but some of our other indicators is here. We see our sub-sites users. These are broken down into the different websites. We have Plan Portsmouth. We can see an incline on the number of users here. Also, the African Burial Ground, you can see that there's been a big upswing there on the number of users. And so forth. So the Park Portsmouth here is right here. So
yeah, and the one thing we're going to be doing is working with going to put out an RFP to refresh our website. And I want to thank Joshua Sear for, you know, just giving us some input on that. And so we're going to be doing that over the next few months.
And then just some statistics on the broadcasting of meetings. The city manager had mentioned that we definitely are seeing an increase here. 2015, we saw 200, and again, we have like 20 more meetings each month now, so we're going to continue to see that climb. But the number of viewers is interesting here, too, so you can really see an upswing on the number of users, so it's good to have those meetings out there. And then the bottom chart, it just indicates the meeting lengths, 480 hours, and then the number of hours that people are spending the time watching these broadcasts. Yeah. That concludes the finance department. If you have any questions.
Josh Messier.
You had mentioned earlier the percentage of properties with a tax lien was very low. I think it was 1% or something like that. Can you give me some insight on what neighboring communities have, just sort of as a comparison? Do we have any?
I think the size, I don't know. Becky, do you have any?
Even if it's just a broad.
I came from a neighboring community, town of Newmarket, where we had 3,500 properties. We have approximately 8,500 properties here. And I had approximately 250 liens in the town of Newmarket. I have 131 properties leaned here.
Thank you.
And Chris, and then Jim?
Just a small point. I like seeing your performance measures, and a suggestion for another one, especially as this number changes, which is the number of elderly, disabled veterans mm-hmm. exemptions that are processed. I think that would be a good performance measure for us to
sure.
track.
We'll add that in. And I think we do currently have, Roseanne, about 120?
We have about 124 from based on last year. This year we'll have more based on the new.
Yeah.
Right.
The new.
Well, the city council is going to have to make a decision on that. And it could be rather impactful to the revenue side of the budget. So we're just going to have to be careful with that. It's going to be a local option for people that have served more than 90 days will be considered. And so we'll have to give you, as Councillor Dwyer said, all the information relative to what we're doing now with elderly, disabled, and veterans on the revenue loss. Of course, the state does pass these laws, but don't provide any financing. It comes from the general taxation.
Jim, you had a question?
Yes, maybe you can answer this, maybe somebody else can, but I do a lot of reading, I think all of us do, and it's clear that while the economy has been sort of in an upturn during the past several years, not a great one, but an upturn, a recession may be pending in this country in the next year or two, and that doesn't mean every place experiences a recession, but are there any indicators from our experiences with the building permits that show that we're on a good trend or that we may be running into some difficulty?
Not right now. We're on a trend. If you looked at the chart, if you did a comparison from where we were when the 2 years before the recession hit in 2008, we're about on that trend. So if you use that trend line, you might be able to extrapolate where you think the recession's gonna be. But you know, if people at the Fed don't know, I certainly probably couldn't tell you. But one thing I want to tell you is that our building department did 12,000 inspections last year. 12,000 with four people.
What kind of inspections?
They do electrical inspections. They do plumbing inspections. They do gas. You know, we have gas stoves, et cetera. Commercial. Construction, residential construction, all those types of things. When anybody pulls a permit for building, they have to go out and inspect. We do have a revenue source that is substantial on the building side, which helps offset that cost.
I just have a quick question, Judy.
Yes.
I know I've seen it in here, the two pie charts that you showed up there with the taxable mm-hmm. properties, residential and commercial. What page is that on?
It's actually in the economic profiles section of the document. Right here, on page 73.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Oh, perfect.
Any other questions? Thank you, Judy.
The next, we've asked that the police chief and Karen come forward and speak to the police department. And as you can see in the tabs, we do have it listed. Let's see.
189.
Thank you, Chief.
Good morning. It's great to be with all of you this Saturday morning.
Nice of you to say.
All right. When we first started looking at our budget for this coming fiscal year, what we did is we did it hand in hand with what could we do to make the department more efficient by reallocating existing resources, eliminating some positions, adding more positions, and also setting some short-term goals that we think are very necessary at the police department. So that was the thought process, and of course, along with staying within the 3%, or at least making a very hard try to stay within that 3%. I had the opportunity before becoming the interim chief from December until January. I was in a transitional role. I started really taking a look at the department, talking to people, ranking officers, line officers, civilian employees, and then once becoming chief, I really had a chance to take a look at this police department. What I found is that we have a very well-trained, highly motivated group of people there. And what I have also found is that they just need, this department just needs some direction. We need to set strategic, we have to do more strategic planning, set some goals, and try to accomplish those goals. Now, I talked about making the department more, more efficient. That is through the organizational changes as well as reporting and workflow changes. The short-term goals I was just talking about is CLIA, becoming a member of CLIA. We're going to talk about that more later. Really get involved with the community through community-oriented policing. The contracts being settled. Now, the contracts at the police station, I have three unions, two are sworn, one is civilian. It really makes a big deal when you, with morale and getting things done, when you've gone that long without a contract. It really does affect the operations to a certain extent. And accountability. And I'm not just talking about the Portsmouth Police Department, I'm talking about any police department. Everybody needs to be held accountable, from the newest person, employee, to the chief. And we're going to talk about that some more. This is staffing before we made the changes. As you can see, we had a deputy chief and we had two captains. Now, what we have done, and we'll talk about this more as well, is looking at the structure. I didn't believe that it was best for the department to have those upper level, I'm sorry. Change is happening fast. Okay. The deputy chief and these captains, taking a look at the workflow, what the duties of both were done, I felt that with the existing supervisory, upper supervisory staff, we could accomplish the same goals, the same duties, by not funding those two positions and adding other positions. As you can see, and we'll talk about patrol first. Now, this is afterwards. As you can see, we took the one captain, put him in the deputy chief position. We had four lieutenants. We still do have four lieutenants, and I put them in charge of divisions. And then here, again, I apologize. I got to get this. And then, and you can see we started a professional standards division. That person we're going to talk about more. That goes to the whole accountability throughout the department, and also will be in charge of the accreditation process as well. Let's start with patrol. As you can see before, patrol had two lieutenants, seven sergeants, and one captain. The captain was in charge of patrol. What we are going to do now is the patrol captain will become the captain of operations, and he will be taking that deputy chief position. One lieutenant was moved out of patrol and put into professional standards. The detective captain and detective chief unfunded positions will now fund two additional sergeants in patrol, so we will have a total of nine sergeants. There are three shifts, day shift, 4 to 12 shift, and then midnight's shift. And we will have three sergeants on each of those shifts and one lieutenant that will be running the patrol division and reporting to the captain. The community police officer will be moved from detectives. Currently, we have a community police officer and detectives, but that community police officer also had a caseload. So she was not, if anybody knows Detective Jones, she's got a lot of energy, and she really attempts to get out there in the community, but she was hampered by those efforts because she had to carry a caseload in detectives. So she is going to be moved to patrol. And we're requesting, in addition to the staff, one officer. Now, that one officer, we're going to be asking for different reasons, but one of those reasons is to be able to have one police officer full-time committed to community policing. And then dispatch, communications, records, court, and IT are going to be moved from patrol. Now, patrol, that is our most important division. Our patrol officers are the ones that go out to emergency calls, that are first responders. They're the ones that really carry the burden of what our mission is. And I want them to just be concentrating on that, those aspects of police work. So to have the, at the time, captain, and now have the lieutenant look after all these things, it just takes away from that mission. Here is detectives. Before, we had one captain, one lieutenant, one sergeant, and you can see the detectives. I've already talked about how we moved the community policing officer from there. Now, because of that, we will now have a detective that takes that position's place, add that to the general detectives, as well as we looked at, another thing we looked at is the prosecutor. We had a sworn police officer who happened to be an attorney doing prosecution. That, to us, that was not a good use of our resources, and I don't believe it's really our mission to be doing that. So we work with the city prosecutor as well as the city manager, and we were able to move that position back into our complement. So that is how we're going to be able to get four detectives, general detectives. Now, right now in detectives, the caseloads are very high. And the officers are juggling a number of cases. So we'd like to give them a little relief there. And general detectives, they handle all the cases that will come in. So if somebody gets their car broken into, somebody gets burglarized, I know that a homeowner or a property owner, they want a lot of attention put to that case. So having four general detectives in there will certainly add to that. Now, you see how I set out this, the ICAC. That is, we in Portsmouth run that program, and we have one sergeant and one detective dedicated to that. 100% of the sergeant's pay in benefits is paid by a grant, and then the detective, it's 80% by the detective. Then the HIDA detective you see down there, he is assigned full-time to a DEA task force. And it's very important with everything going on with the heroin epidemic that we participate in that. What happens is we get to, although we're taking one detective out of our complement, so to speak, we are getting a lot more resources through the federal government in this task force. And we get a good bang for our buck for that. But the reason I set them out is so we don't, they're really not handling cases. They're not handling cases. So they we don't count them towards our complement. And professional standards. Now, professional standards, Lieutenant, he is going to be in charge of CALEA, internal investigations, citizens' complaints, accountability throughout the department, ensure that standard operating procedures are followed and updated, going to be managing our evaluation tracking system, and all of this will foster accountability. And also, he's going to be our liaison through federal, state agencies, courts, the attorney generals, et cetera.
Chief, maybe you could explain a little bit about CALEA and the acronym and what it is. I don't think we've gone through that at all.
Yes,
further on.
I definitely will do that. Now, when I talk about evaluations, when I mentioned that, right now, currently, we don't have any evaluation in the department, throughout the department. Nobody gets evaluated. In any company, any kind of organization, to me, it's a necessity. You can't really operate any business or organization without evaluating your people and what you're doing. So it's currently an issue that is in negotiations. And once the contracts are settled, we're hoping to be able to get evaluations going right away. And what we're doing is we've entered into a contract with a software company that's going to track discipline. Now, discipline is not just punishing people. Discipline is recognizing people. It's a way to evaluate the people that work within an organization. If somebody does something very well and somebody takes note of that, it goes on to the disciplinary record. If somebody makes a mistake, it goes on to the disciplinary record. So somebody might make a mistake 6 months before, and if you don't document that, and then the person makes the same mistake, you're not really correcting that mistake. So that is, and also it can be used for when we're talking about promotions, we're talking about special assignments. It's also going to be a valuable tool for that. You can see all the good things that people did as well. We had such a system in my former job, and the vast majority of things that go into a discipline database are positive in nature. And it's a great tool to be able to use. It's a great tool to develop your staff. You can tell what training they need, and if there is an issue, that issue does not fester. We are able to see it right away, and we can address it. And that goes with the accountability throughout the department. Citizens' complaints. We have a system in place, and I think it is a decent system, but we need to track our complaints better. Internal investigations, if we need to be able to address that in a more timely fashion and do it more uniformly. And then let's move on to personnel and training. We have a lieutenant before. That's not going to change. We're still going to have a lieutenant. But that lieutenant's also going to be responsible for these other things that the patrol division was responsible for before. And keep in mind that we do have, for instance, in communications, there is a communications supervisor that'll be watching over there. We have in records, we have supervisory staff there as well. Administrative services, that is not going to change. The only thing that is going to change is currently we have a part-time data entry clerk. We are proposing to make that clerk full-time. She does a lot of work, and we are going to have her also doing work down in the records unit so we can provide more, we can provide better service to the community and keep that window down there open longer. And she's also going to be, right now, we're trying to go paperless in a lot of things. We're trying to take our old records and put them into the computer, and she's going to be doing a lot of that work as well. Now, here's our staffing before and after. As you can see, the deputy chief position is unfunded. Captain position is unfunded. After this, the result, net result, will be three more sergeants. Lower level supervision is a lot more important to upper level. I wanted to flatten the organization. I wanted communication to be flowing up and down a lot better. I also wanted to be able to take my lieutenants, four of them, they are upper management. I wanted to put them in charge of divisions, and I will hold them accountable. The captain, I will hold the captain accountable. The captain holds the four lieutenants accountable, and it should go right down the line. And so that is why we wanted to make those changes. As you can see, prosecutor, we're using that to have an addition in detective division. And let me talk about the accreditation manager a little bit. Let's get to, see if we can get to. Here are the goals that I mentioned before. Now let's talk about CLEAR. It's a commission of accreditation for law enforcement agencies. And these are the things that it does. It greater accountability within the agency, reduce risk and liability exposure, stronger defense against civil lawsuits, staunch support from government officials, and it increases community advocacy. And what it basically does is it gives you standards that are best practices in law enforcement. You follow, you have to adopt these standards, then you have to follow those standards. And it takes it a step further. What happens is every 3 years, a group from CLEAR will come in. They're experts. They will come in and they will take a look at whether or not we're following the procedures, the best practices, and then they'll issue a report. That report is public. So the public is able to see what we are doing in the department, and they'll be able to see the accountability there, what we've done good, what we've done bad. During the process, and let me just go here and start talking about what that process is. So far, these are the things we've done. We've joined the Northern New England Police Accreditation Coalition. I have a lieutenant from Professional Standards has been attending the monthly meetings. In a process, we'd like to, if this budget goes through, hire an accreditation manager. We've already enrolled in CLEAR. We've begun the self-assessment phase. It's a 1 to 3 year process to become accredited. Then there will be that on-site assessment I talked about. And part of that on-site assessment, there is a community input part of that. The community comes to a meeting, and they can talk about their police department, report to CLEAR what they think is good about the police department, what they think needs improvement, and that all is addressed in the report. There's also a call-in session where anybody can call in to the assessors. And then afterwards, there's a review, and then the report, and again, that report is made public. And then after you become accredited, it's a constant process of maintaining compliance and reaccreditation. Now, in Manchester, we were accredited since the early 90s. During my tenure as chief of police, I went through three accreditation processes. And what I liked about it is that we had people from the outside coming and taking a look at what we were doing. And it's something that police departments shouldn't be afraid of. It's good to have somebody take a look at what you're doing and then give you an assessment. So I look forward to it. And I also liked about it, as I talked about before, the community can be involved. And then afterwards, it's transparency. The community can see what a group of experts have to say about their police department. In accountability, I talked about the evaluations already. Supervisory oversight of assigned employees. What I have found in patrol, especially, that we have our sergeants in patrol were not assigned particular employees. The patrolmen weren't reporting to anybody in particular. It's essential that in police work, especially as I told about how these officers, patrol officers, that are backbone of the department, they're going to some calls where they are going to be having to make decisions that they have to make split second. They have to make determinations of whether a law was broken and what action to take. They make decisions that in a matter of moments that are going to be scrutinized. If you think about it, they decide whether to arrest somebody or search a vehicle. And then afterwards, the decisions they make are looked at by their supervisors, by the prosecutor, by defense attorneys, ultimately by a judge and by the public. So we want to make sure they're out there and they're doing the right things. We want to make sure that we're constantly training them. And that's what a part of your job as a supervisor is, to constantly train the officers out in the street, to constantly give them the tools and information that they need to do their jobs. So we have good supervisors out there, but they didn't have employees assigned particularly to them. The creation of professional standards division I talked about, CLEAR I talked about, and keeping the public informed about the department. And that is done through CLEAR, as well as in our yearly reports, talking about what kind of discipline, what kind of, how many citizen complaints we had, what were the results of the investigations, just keeping, being transparent, letting the people know that we're doing our job. And when I talk about evaluations too, I believe the chief, myself, I believe the police commission, or whoever the chief will be in the future, should get evaluated as well. I think it's something that top to bottom, civilian, sworn, supervisory, everybody needs to be evaluated. Community policing. These are the things that we want to do with community policing. We want to increase contact with youth, especially kids at risk. We want to collaborate with the school department. We've started to do that. We're going to be talking about some of the events that and things that we're going to be doing with the schools. Collaborate with the housing authority. What we're going to be doing this summer, we're going to be taking our school resource officers once school ends, and we're going to have them work with our community police officer. We're going to spend a lot of time with the housing areas. We're going to be trying to reach out to the kids, because when kids, at-risk kids leave school, they still are at risk. We shouldn't have put off having contact with them until the school year starts again. We also want them to spend some more time downtown being our ambassadors. So during the time in the summer when we have a lot of people downtown, we want them to be ambassadors not only for the police department, but also for the city. We're looking to partnering with the business community. We've already been in contact with the Chamber of Commerce to try to get that facilitated. During the summer, we'll be collaborating with the Recreation Department to bring a basketball league back so we can have some positive interaction with kids. We're going to be doing business residential security surveys. We've been partnering with Senior Services to do some things as well. And also, we want to really get involved with neighborhood issue resolution and watch programs. And here's some of the things we're doing. We're partnering with the school department and other social service agencies. On the 26th, we're going to be having a forum on the opiate crisis. We're going to be showing a movie that was made by the FBI. We're encouraging everybody that could go to that, because the more we educate the public about what's going on with that, the better everybody will be. Community policing with the school district. We are going to be holding what we call Cops with Kids. We are going to be going to each elementary school, and we're going to bring out all the bells and whistles. We're going to have our equipment outside. We're going to do a canine demonstration, and we're going to have the kids go from station to station talking to the police officers about what their jobs are and being able to ask them questions. That if we do that every single year from kindergarten to fifth grade before they leave elementary school, that's 6 years of positive interaction with the police department. And I already talked about the basketball. We want to do some more outreach with the seniors. They are some of the people that in the community that are underrepresented, and their needs sometimes are really not addressed. So what we want to do is start letting the seniors in the city get familiarized with us and vice versa. So we're going to be doing it twice a month during the warm weather, just getting together and walking and talking, and good opportunity for us to get to know them, and they can make some new friends and be able to talk to us and know us as well. And we already talked about the school resource officers. We've started a PPD TV. It's not going to win any Emmys, but I think it's good. I think it's good to let the public find out what I found out. When I got here, started talking to the different officers, I talked about how well-trained they are and how enthusiastic and motivated they are. And that's what the public needs to know, who they have serving them. So we're going to continue doing that. Now, contracts. I talked about that, and I know that you as a council, the city manager, have a fiscal responsibility, and you have to take all that into account. But from a police chief's point of view, I look at what our department, the line officers, the rank and file civilians and officers have gone through the last couple of years. During that whole time, they have never stopped answering their calls. They've never stopped stopping cars. They have never stopped getting dangerous people off the street. During that time, they've been out of contract. And I think it would go a long way to just getting us back to doing what a police department should be doing, providing public safety. So I'm hoping we can settle these contracts as soon as possible. And as you can see, compared to other municipalities, they are on the lower end of the pay scale, and that does mean a lot. And when I look at Portsmouth, before I came here, Portsmouth in the Seacoast, to me, that is the police department I always thought of. Portsmouth is just like in Manchester. I always thought of Manchester was the premier law enforcement agency. And from where I was in Manchester, that is the way that I've always thought about it here on the Seacoast. And so we talked about accreditation management. Accreditation is a tedious process. You have to go through all of your policies, all of your SOPs. You have to revamp everything. It is very monotonous, and it's something you have to have somebody stay on that full-time. And that is why we really need an accreditation manager. Once we get accredited, that person is not only going to be doing making sure that we are keeping up and always looking at our standard operating procedures, but also is going to be assisting with data entry and other bookkeeping work in helping the lieutenant in professional standards. The detective sergeant that we're adding, these are things we need. Child abuse neglect, with new reporting state guidelines, we're getting a lot more cases. Juvenile crimes, juvenile prosecution, we want somebody to really focus on that. And the new officer, again, it's going to free up the officer to do strictly community policing. And also, it's going to be, the whole goal of community policing is to get the whole department going on it. So what we start out is, we start out with these programs, all this outreach, and then after that, we expect our officers to start going to community meetings, to start initiating things. And I already talked about what the clerk will be doing. So here are the numbers. Here's how it worked when we going through the budget. We really tried very hard to stay within the 3%. The city manager worked with us, and we really appreciate it. And I would point out, if it wasn't for that workman's comp that the city manager talked about, that would have been $68,000 that we wouldn't have had to allocate in our budget towards that, and we would have been within the 3%. And what we've done with the workman's comp issue is we've met with Primex, our insurance carrier, and we've talked to them to see what the problems were, what the issues. We've already made sure, we're starting to make sure that we utilize light duty, and we have been. And we also, it goes kind of hand in hand. An officer, a patrol officer, came up with an initiative for a physical fitness twice a year testing, make it voluntary. And he came up with a plan, he's tweaking it, and I think that might go to a long way to that as well. And keep in mind, with workman's comp, with police officers, it's just the nature of the job. You never can predict how many officers are going to get injured. And that's it. And I'm here to answer any questions.
Is there any other question?
Yes. You're doing great things with your department. You know, it's so exciting compared to some of the experiences we've recently had. Could you address two things? One, are you doing ethics training, and what are your plans along those lines? And secondly, can you generally address, even though it's not in this budget, the concept of it seems to fit into CALEA very well, the concept of body cams and car cams for police officers as a future budget item?
As far as ethics go, the whole department was trained, and we're going to continue to do that with new officers. We plan on doing that as well. In ethics, we trained the whole department in ethics, and it kind of sends out the message that our department was unethical. I'm telling you, I'm not finding that with the people I have there now. So as long as we always focus on doing what our jobs are, following our training and doing what's right, and holding everybody accountable, I think that'll go a long way. So, but we are going to continue to train new employees with that. And as far as body cameras go, the concept of it, and you and I had that discussion, but the concept of body cameras, I'm not against. It's a matter of priorities at this time. I think if body cameras, if you look at it, I think it cuts down on complaints. I think if in the long run it is advantageous to the police officer and the police department. However, it is the cost, and I know you have an opinion on that, and the cost of it and what our priorities are at this time. As far as we do not get a lot of complaints from the citizens' complaints of brutality and things of that nature. And I would rather spend the time, money, and energy on training our officers. But in the future, the concept of it, I'm not opposed to it. We always operate with, we're always doing the right things and following our training. We have nothing to worry about.
Quick follow-up. If we're going to have a conversation about that in the next year, and I'm going to try to generate it, it is very cost-effective. There's a lot of information out there. And I'll be, with your permission, forwarding you some of the ways that it can be done very cheaply, including those professional companies that offer it on a contractual basis of as low as $55 an officer per month, including storage, which makes it very cost-effective. Other cities and towns in the New England area found that. On the walk with a cop for senior citizens, and this will be my last question, I like that idea, but is there a promise that they're not going to walk too fast?
We're going to make sure the officers there are physically fit to keep up with them. So.
That's good.
Yeah, Josh Tenton and then Chris.
I have two questions regarding body cameras to follow up on Assistant Mayor Splains. I've been told that there's legislation at the State House currently. Has that passed yet?
The legislation, I don't know what the status is of it, Kyle, but the legislation in there made it an option for municipalities, but it was going to mandate state police to it.
And then when it comes to storage, I know body cameras are relatively new. Has there been a set standard on the best form of storage for police departments to adopt, or is that still in flux?
They've come a long way. When I was in Manchester, I was looking towards demoing a couple of cameras, body cameras. And then once we got, and I know this is a couple of years ago, but once we got the cost of the storage, and it was cost prohibited, because again, it's a larger department though, so cost for a smaller department would be different. And another thing about body cameras that I think have to be worked out is this, how long do you store the film? Is it subject to the public? Could the public request under the right to know law and have access to that? And what would that process be? How time consuming? Do we have to actually have somebody doing that full time or at least part time to be able to do that? Those are the things that I worry about it.
Thank you.
If I could just address Josh's question, because I've been following the legislation. The committee at this point is considering having it studied, which happens a lot, and which happens a lot with a lot of legislation that's got some complications. And it's not needed, the legislation is not needed for New Hampshire towns or cities to be able to do something on body cams. Several already have, and the requirement for the state police has been taken out of it. So there's not a requirement at this point, even under the study procedure. If you check the internet, by the way, you will find that hundreds and hundreds of cities and towns throughout the nation have body cams already. And there are a number of procedures. As the captain says, there's a variety of ways to go about it.
Chris, you had a question?
Two comments and a couple of questions. First of all, I'm really pleased to see the continued flattening of the department, because it's something that the council has been asking for a long time, and steps have been taken toward flattening over almost now a four-year period, I think. So it's great to see that move forward. And I just want to put out there, just as a reminder, the council can't do anything about a contract until we see one. So we haven't seen one in those 3 years that you talked about either. So that's we hope to see one. A question about the CALEA. You know, I think it's a great step and a step in the right direction. Every profession that I'm familiar with has accreditation of various types, and but rarely, in my experience, whether it's in a higher ed or daycare or school systems who do a very similar kind of accreditation process, very rarely would you designate an employee to be in charge of accreditation. It's assumed that it's part of distributed roles for a variety of reasons. And I wonder in this case if this is something that, a position that we need at the beginning of being part of CALEA to kind of get our act together, so to speak, and that's mm-hmm. something that over a couple years might become a normal function, as it would be in other professions.
My experience that I have found is that to have the one person constantly doing that and constantly looking at a standard operating procedures, constantly out there within the department in the building, making sure things are being done, is invaluable. And it's not just that the buildup, that is a lot of it. It is the buildup towards it is certainly the most time intensive part of the job, but you still have to continue to show, they call them proofs, you still have to continue to show that you're following your procedures, and it is a time-consuming endeavor. And I understand you're concerned, and that is why we are going to have that person assisting the professional standards lieutenant with making sure that our database, discipline database, and other paperwork is getting done as well.
So that person will have other functions, and maybe those functions would increase over time.
Yes.
Yeah, and I was glad to see that was a civilian position as well. A question around training, and partly this comes from all the attention that the State Police Training Academy and how to fund that has had over the last 6 months or so. And I've heard a lot about that, heard a lot about that through our legislators and through from other communities, what an excellent job that that academy does. And yet I know that we've always, when we've hired a new police officer here, added a lot to that training. And given that you've got a lot of vacancies and you'll be hiring a lot of people, do you still anticipate that that's true? Do you still anticipate that we have the need for, I think it was about 16 paid weeks of additional training when they're hired?
We're looking at that. I had taken a look at it. What happens in our process with the new officers is that they drive around with different police officers. They are assigned to different police officers. They learn all the job functions. They learn all the paperwork. And that goes on for quite a while. What is good about the state academy is they get that certification, they get the same training everybody else gets, but then when you come back to your city or your municipality, it's important to show them that there are all different nuances and differences how it's done. But I'm always looking to see how we can shorten that process. Right now, we are down, what is it? Four police officers, and if we get the additions here, we're going to be hiring.
Well, total of seven right this second, if we get the additional.
And what we're really trying to stress is getting officers that have already been police officers.
Okay.
And that'll shorten the process even more.
That'll change that, yeah. Just one more question then.
Yes.
Because you have been carrying those vacancies, do you anticipate this year that you'll end the year with a surplus? I mean, I'm looking at the balance between, even though you're not asking for a great increase, of what was spent this year and what will be spent next year.
In terms of surplus, what we project right now, we are projecting approximately a $50,000 surplus right now, because even though we've had the vacancies, we've had to backfill at least in the dispatch hour for hour on overtime.
Okay.
So that ate up a lot of the salary savings, to so to speak. We also had to encumber the money for the chief search. So
right.
That was another $40,000 to $50,000 that we're encumbering. So. We should see about a $50,000, hopefully, surplus, okay. Maybe a little more.
Thank you, Karen.
Your Honor.
Thank you.
Could I ask a question? So first, this is, I've seen a lot of police budget presentations, and I think this is one of the more thorough ones. So thank you for presenting that. So good work. I have some questions in terms of the overall FTE count is going up 5%, which is a lot in 1 year. And even though I agree with everything you're saying strategically in terms of where you want to go with the organization, I think, like Chris said, in terms of the long-term goals of flattening the structure, but I'm still struggling to support. I mean, it's one of the probably the only department that's going up 5 FTE, and it's hard for me to wrap my head around that big of a leap, and I'm not there yet. So I'm wondering, is there a way to achieve some of the same goals, but keep the total full-time count the same, or maybe add one person instead of adding 5%. And look at the, not just the headcount, but then the budget increase of 3.39, I think it is. That doesn't include possibly settled contracts, which would again make that increase, the effective increase for the year, much higher than 3%. So that's where I'm kind of struggling there, because I support everything you've laid out strategically in terms of your goals, but financially and in terms of headcount, I'm not there yet. And I'm maybe if you can speak to that somewhat.
Where's the?
Keep going.
Okay, it's a net change, but again, we took two of the higher salaries and we eliminated those. And if you look at a department our size, and I look back historically, At one point, I believe within the last 10 years, the complement of full-time sworn employees was 71. Now, during the time, since that time, if you, and again, I haven't been here, I'm just what I've researched, I've been in talking to people. If you look at what's happened with the downtown, the events, new, all these more people moving in and all the activity, I think that it is necessary for us to stay up with what's going on in Portsmouth, that not just status quo, and we're trying to, and I can't say modernize the police department, I'm just trying to get us up to what is proper best practices. And I think in when we are looking at the restructure and how to make us more, and trying to make us more efficient, we did keep in mind about not trying to add a lot of positions. We're trying to do what the most we could do with what we had, and I still think it was a pretty good accomplishment to be able to stay pretty close within that budget. And again, working with the city manager, two of those positions are not going to come, and I forgot to mention this, aren't going to come until the halfway point of the fiscal year. So I believe that we need to keep pace with what is going on in the city.
Yes, Councilor Lown.
Thank you, Chief, and Karen also for that presentation. I also thought it was very good, and the changes you're suggesting seem sensible to me. But on this chart here, the civilian employees increasing by four, is that, I'm sorry if I missed this, is one of those, would one of those?
It's a total of four.
Oh, okay. Is one of those the?
Part-time clerk going to full-time.
Part-time clerk, and then the accreditation manager. Okay, all right. And then the only other thing is the workers' comp increase of 68,000, which is a big jump. I just assume that's based on whatever happened in the last year or two that causes the rating to go up or not?
No, it was I don't know what the formula was. I don't know if you can explain that in reference to the workers' comp. It was a reallocation of.
I think the reallocation was done in such a way as to actually reflect the actual experience of the department. Before, we were using the mod factor of 0.97 for everybody. And so this was a way to get people to pay attention to what we want to do. And the chief jumped on it right away and met with Primex, and I think we're in a good path. I think he's set us up so that you'll see that level out over the next couple of years. And again, we're very appreciative of him moving forward on the best practices when it comes to workers' compensation.
So it's not based on actual claims, it's just a reevaluation. Okay, I see.
In other words, the fire department was probably paying some of our.
Well, it depends on, it's all based on the percentage of why our mod has increased, and the mod has increased, and Diana probably can explain it better. I'll let her do so, but you can come up here, Diana, and just explain, because it really is something that we needed to pay attention for years. We didn't move on this, and it was very frustrating for us because the other departments were actually subsidizing the police department. But the chief took it and ran with it, and we're very pleased.
Yeah, exactly. In the past, the way we had calculated the premiums was purely based on audited payroll dollars by department. Then they would take our the claims for the whole pool based on classification of positions, police officer, what their rates, their experiences for that particular classification, and they would determine a rate for them based on the whole entire pool. They would take that rate, and obviously police, fire, public works is going to be a much higher because they're prone to having higher claims, multiplied times the dollars of that department. Then they multiply it times the experience mod factor. And what that modification factor is, it's how the cities compare to each other in the pool. So they figure out how much based on everything, how we do. So we are a little bit below the rest of the pool. And as a result, because it's 0.97, they take what the premium was, they multiply that times 0.97. So we actually get a 3% reduction because of that. If it goes over one, we have an increase. So we've always just done it purely based on that. And as the city manager had said,
Every department had been working hard to keep that rate down, and we've been seeing a slight increase in experience modification. We were at 0.88 last year, so we had a significant jump this year, which even though we got a decrease, the decrease was a lot less because that mod is going up higher. So last year, we would have had a 12% decrease. This year, we only had a 3% decrease, and then our payroll dollars went up. So we had talked about it, and we put the police on, we gave them, told, talked to them 2 years ago, and we said, you know, you got to start doing light duty. You got to start working with us. We had Primex come in. They tried to work with them, gave them some ideas for light duty, and it just wasn't happening. So we told them we'd give them 2 years to try to work and to get those rates down. And if they didn't, we were going to then change the allocation and start charging it, because they were the driving force for our mod factor going up. So now that we've done that, as I said, Chief Mara's right on top of it. They've got light duty. I think they have like a year's worth of light duty work that they've already figured out to do, and everybody is now coming back to work. And so in the experience mods, it's based over 7 years. It's not just 1 year. So it's going to take a few years before you actually see a result. It's not going to be immediate.
Thank you, Diana.
You're welcome.
Joshua?
Just real quick, since the body cams were brought up, I would be interested in not even a conversation I think we have today, but just to planting a seed for thoughts later on what the CLIA might have for, you know, best practices and guidance for anything around that for storage and access and all that. I think that would be important to have in the picture. And then also, just really quickly, for our audience, our millions of viewers at home, I think most of us understand what the ICAC is, but I don't know that necessarily the general public would understand that. And there was a chart where you were explaining while some of it was funded and it wasn't counted towards FTE. So maybe you can explain a little bit about that.
Yes, it's Internet Crimes Against Children. And it's a statewide grant-funded task force that we administer the grant. And what it does is if there is any crime perpetrated over the Internet, the officers are specially trained to take a part of a computer, and be able to extract the information and then put together investigations for that. And they've had great success doing that.
And so we have funds for officers to do that specifically that aren't necessarily counted in our budget because it comes from that grant?
20 for one of the officers. We have one sergeant and one patrolman, one detective. The sergeant is 100% funded, and the detective is 80% grant funded.
And that's enough to cover basically all that work and
yes.
Tasks that are related. Thank you.
And I just have one last comment, and I feel a little differently than Councilor Spear, but I'm glad that we're seeing patrolmen increase to hiring. Having been in Portsmouth, particularly downtown, for the last many, many years, when Portsmouth first started growing, pretty much in the mid-'80s, you know, it was a less safe place than it is today, and part of the reason was we didn't have enough downtown presence of police officers. There was a day when we used to have to escort our employees to their cars late at night. We never left them leaving ones, and you know, there had been some more problems. In the last several recent years, we don't have that many. It's not a dangerous city for such an active city, and we have so much going on. So I do applaud the fact that we will have more officers on the street, particularly in the downtown, because as we grow and we want to maintain that safety attraction that we have to our downtown and to the rest of the cities, particularly with the opioid crisis increasing. And so I'm a little different school thinking the hiring extra police officers is a great idea.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
We'll
move on to the next.
The fire department, that's page 207, and the fire chief is here, and we can probably run through those slides to get to his.
Good morning, everybody.
Thank you for having us to present our budget again, and hopefully we can answer any questions you have as we go through. My name is Steve Achilles. I'm the fire chief, your fire chief. These are the essential services that we provide to the city of Portsmouth, and it's not just the citizens, but the visitors and the workers and all taxpayers that own businesses. We're known, of course, for our fire protection services and our ambulance services, but a lot of people don't realize that we do hazardous materials and disaster response. We do marine and waterfront emergencies. A large portion of our work is behind the scenes in fire prevention inspection. I serve as your emergency management coordinator under the city manager as the emergency management director. So we facilitate disaster and mitigation planning, and we get to that budget, I'll have a brief slide. And there's a lot of community services that we do out into the public. Incident activity for 2015, we are about 4,639 incidents. You can see how that compares. We were up about 300 incidents over last year. 2,700 were fire-related, and 3,300 were EMS-related. You'll see that those numbers, if you add those up, are larger than 4,600, because there are occasions, a number of occasions, when the fire truck and ambulance go together on an incident. But if we were to look at actual incidents, single incidents by themselves, it's about 4,600, so our calls are going up. One of the things that we're fortunate is we have an ambulance service. We've had an ambulance service in the city of Portsmouth since 1945. Some time ago, way before I got here, there was an ability to bill for services rendered. It does follow all the requirements of Center for Medicare Services Insurance, so we can only bill for transports, and we follow that rule. And we're fortunate that we've had a 77.8% collection rate over the last 5 years. So there are a portion of emergency incidents that we cannot bill for, or we don't get revenue from, or we can't collect. But as you can see, the net billing for FY15 or calendar year 15 was about $825,000, and that's adjusted. So the actual amount is much less than that, and it's probably in the $700,000 range. But I would refer to finance if that was is that the correct number. This is something that does not go back into our budget, as you understand. It goes in the general fund. But I think when you look at our budget, this is something that we put back in, and you could take that number off our budget to see where we how well we're doing. Position summary, it's been pretty consistent. Last year, we added a position to cover some long-term vacancies, and we'll continue that. So we're at 62, so there's no net changes in our staffing. Well, what we, when we were working with the Joint Budget Committee and working with the city manager and finance and HR, our budget request is about $8.2 million. It's just under the 3% proposed limit. Things that we're looking at, of course, that step increases, the New Hampshire retirement, our health insurance, and then there was a reallocation of telephone services because we were lumped in and we weren't paying our fair share over the last number of years, so we are that has gone up. Of course, this budget maintains our current level of service and our staffing. Make sure we run all three stations, and we maintain the adequate resources that to do our meet our mission. What it doesn't include is any new collective bargaining agreements, and we do have a tentative agreement reached with the firefighters that you'll see in the near future, which we're really pleased with, both the work that our negotiator did and also the firefighters did. And we're still working with the officer's contract. One of the things that we presented over the last couple of years was our self-assessment, and I think this is a great time to let you know where things were meeting. And it sounds minimal, but
simple things that we started looking at in our budget is even our linen contract, our towels, sheets, things that are required by contract and provide for overnight accommodations and so forth. And we, working with the legal department, went out to another business, and we're saving about $10,000 a year just in linen. We did work with Public Works, installed LED lighting at Station 1, and slowly we're moving into, I think we've completed projects at Station 2 and Station 3, and we're looking at about $2,600 a year in savings. In the deployment and staffing areas, we did, in this past November, reach out to the insurance services organization to look at our fire protection class. We did a present all the information, and we were hoping if that class would have changed, that it would improve insurance rating for the larger businesses and the homeowners. Essentially, we are the same. So after an extensive evaluation by that organization, we are at the same level. Shift replacement overtime. We did begin a dialogue with labor on wellness fitness initiative. And this is kind of relates to that time off the floor related to injuries and illnesses. We're still in that discussion, but what we've done across all three stations has made sure that there was exercise and cardiovascular wellness equipment at all three stations. So it's a volunteer program, but we're doing it on site, and we're actually getting a lot of buy-in for that. So that's the first step in a wellness fitness initiative, and at some point we're, I'm sure we'll be looking at other opportunities. Also, we did have a trial of a one additional firefighter to reduce overtime. That was due to a long-term vacancy. That was working, but I will let you know that the long-term vacancy came back early. So we really didn't get to exercise that for a full year. And we're also negotiating an option of alternative work schedule with the officers union for an administrative, kind of a dual administrative officer that can fill shift duties. That's in negotiating now, negotiations now. As far as facilities and the self-assessment, there was this idea of renovation versus construction of Station 3, and that will come up in capital. And we're looking at $600,000 cost versus a $2 million cost. Customer satisfaction, we did launch our Facebook page to coincide with Fire Prevention Week. We have over 600 followers, and that's just a way that we can put out quick information to the public, also get feedback from the public, and develop programs or educational programs for people that they can see. And in vehicle apparatus, starting in April, we, as you are well aware of, that we are transitioning our current fireboat to a smaller, more versatile vessel, and we hope to save some money with that. Things I think that we have to pay attention to, as and we have been monitoring this over the last couple of years, much like the police department and other city services that are feeling the pressure of positive growth and development within the city, and are, you know, a great economic climate. We are seeing that continued commercial industrial development in all areas of the city, including the trade port, the downtown, and Lafayette Road, and with those more developments and more occupancies, whether they be residential or commercial, we have to protect those, and we have to respond to the workers, the visitors that go to these occupancies. We also, and we're, most of us are well aware of the projected and new residential developments that are looking at the West End, Lafayette Road, and downtown in the bypass. And depending on those occupancies, they move forward. If they're residential occupancies, such as in the West End with the redevelopment of the Frank Jones properties, or the larger unit that's supposed to go in at Southgate Plaza behind that, again, that will add more residents, and residential properties create a unique risk to us because people live there and work there. We're going to be paying attention to that as the growth continues. We are seeing an increase in the day and multi-day visitors, and that is evident in our hotels, in our lodging occupancies. And if the development goes through on the property next to the Sheridan, that will again increase our visitors and overnight lodging, which, as we all know, increases our population, or the population we're supposed to protect. Along with all this great economic development and redevelopment, our inspections department, which consists of two people, are extremely busy with plans reviews as far as fire and life safety, any renovations, and then any place of assembly or an occupancy that has over 50 people or serves alcohol needs to be inspected on a regular basis. So we're slowly seeing some pressure on our inspectors and our deputy chief to balance that. And of course, we have a continuing aging population, and the largest percent of our ambulance and fire calls are for the population over 55 years old. And the last thing that I think that we envision that is going to be some challenges this year is, and has been, is every time there's infrastructure repair, not just from the city side, but from the state, when it comes to bridges, which we know there's a number of bridges still being going to go out of service, wastewater treatment facility, which is going to create some traffic, and the parking garage, and all the roads and repairs. This creates a challenge for us to move across the city. That's why it's imperative that we still deploy and have three stations, that we put the resources not in just one location, but throughout the city as we do, so that we can get across the city in a timely fashion and meet the expectations of the residents and the visitors. So I will, if you want, I'll answer any questions on the fire department, or I can do the emergency management, and then we can, you can answer any on both.
Any questions? Yeah, Councilor Lau.
Thank you, Chief. My ears really perked up when you mentioned the trial of one additional firefighter to reduce overtime. I guess somebody was out, and what was that? What happened to that firefighter that joined the department for the purpose of filling in?
With some anticipated movement in the department and a retirement, we kept that firefighter on. The intention was one of our firefighters joined the military full-time and was supposed to be away for 5 years. That changed, so we anticipated this extra firefighter covering that vacancy until somebody left. So we were able to do that for about 9 months. I don't think we saw all the cost savings because 3 months prior to that, the individual was in the military, came back. So we get to
That's
try it for
6 months. Of not having to pay overtime, which is a very good thing in my opinion. And you said, after you mentioned that, Chief, you mentioned that you are looking to look at ways to fulfill these shift replacement with some person. Who would that person be? A part-time?
What we're looking at is, because of some of the administrative duties we have that aren't being met, specifically in areas of emergency medical services, managing that, and maybe some outlet for our prevention or inspection department. The thought is to have a officer that is a full-time member of the department that is assigned administrative duties, and they would be assigned weekdays, 4 days a week, and they would be eligible for filling an officer vacancy during that 4 days, and we anticipate maybe some portion of that. Right now, we do not have an extra officer. As the contract's written right now, if an officer's out, they are replaced by an off-duty officer at overtime. So there's really no flexibility. There's no, like on the firefighter side of it, we have some one in reserve each shift, so we can move that down. So we'd like to try that. One, it provides some break for us, but it's a ranking officer that can still fulfill supervisory role, but also can fill in administrative duties and shift duties.
Thank you.
Yes, Counselor Dwyer.
Two questions. I was interested in the insurance rating, and I, sometime during the year, it kind of caught my attention, and I was surprised, actually. I think it was when the Newcastle discussion occurred. I was surprised that they're not rated that much differently than we are, and that sort of shocked me. So could you talk about why we didn't get a better rating, or what factors go into that?
I don't know when the last time Newcastle was rated, so I can't speak to their numbers. You're rated on municipal water supply, which we have a pretty solid municipal water supply. The processing and transferring of calls, you know, 911 and that process. And then your deployment of resources. And we're some of, because of our, we've been consistent staffing in deployment of two engines, a ladder, and two ambulances. We are not in a position, if you could increase, and this is where the, what's the financial benefit of adding another fire truck or adding other reserve pieces that are that could be staffed, that cost versus the insurance savings. So we were hoping we would move up. Mm-hmm. But because of our consistent staffing, and we really haven't changed for quite a long time, even though we're doing better in training, I think they saw that as a, we haven't improved.
Mm-hmm. And then my other question was related to opioids. I noticed that you didn't list that in your challenges, and I just wanted to hear from you the effect on how that affects or not the department. Does that relate to some of your increase in calls or?
I didn't specifically note a number of medical incidents or occurrences, but opioid is still a challenge to our department, along with the police department. We're seeing probably two or three overdoses a week, not all heroin related, but that's, I think, where we see this. Again, as you incrementally, we didn't have a jump of 100 or 200 calls in one specific area, but we have found that we're the frequencies of those types of calls, and they're starting to compete or overlap onto other calls, will be a challenge. And you know, been working with the recovery center, we've been working with the hospital and local healthcare to see in police department what we can do to reduce that.
Eric, and then Joshua.
So thank you for the budget, and I think I support the budget as requested. I think it's a good one for this year. I still want to make a pitch for the efficiency study that we talked about a couple years ago. I think your self-assessment is right on target, and I all of the bullets that you listed there, I support those as well. The we just heard from the police chief talking about how the value of an outside pair of eyes coming in and looking at his department. And I think for the fire department, it could be the same benefit. One of the things in talking with some people about this, I was asked, well, is there anything really, do you have any struggles with the budget as it is now? And I don't, I think it's good. But I think that's exactly the appropriate time to do this sort of study, because these studies are often strategic in nature, and they're not reactionary to some crisis happening right now. And so when the economy is good and when the taxes are reasonable, that's when we should take these long-term approaches. Because having gone through the recession, when we were scrambling and closing Station 3 and trying, everyone was, you know, laying people off, it was the wrong way to manage things. And I think if we can have an efficiency, or call it something better, like an assessment, I guess, something that gets us a strategic outline for the future. We won't be reacting when a recession comes, which obviously it's going to come at some point. It has to. The economy grows and then it contracts. I'd rather be in a position where we're ready for it as a department, and all the departments to some at one point or another have gone through some of these exercises. And I think if the council funded the assessment, it wouldn't be, I wouldn't want to take it from your budget. Like I said, I think you have a good budget. So wanted to make a pitch again for this and see, well, number one, obviously, the council would have to support the expenditure, but also I'd only want to do it if the department was a willing participant to look at some of these type of long-term issues that might be either to increase better service or increase cost savings.
Well, I know that this is something that was presented in the last couple of years and didn't move forward. But much like the police department, I think the better path is the accreditation process. In this past year, I went down to a conference and workshop on the accreditation process, and we thought, much the same as been discussed earlier, that we could do the accreditation process ourselves. There's a national accrediting agency for fire services that does mirrors what the police department and law enforcement does. What we learned is, and you're going to see a standard cover document come out that's part of that accreditation that we're going to do by our based on that practice. We're not seeking accreditation now, but it is a lot larger endeavor than reassigning or giving people multiple duties. All across the nation, that accredited agencies for fire, they do have an accreditation manager that tracks all statistics, does all the assessment, and then works with different departments within the department with a liaison. So I think a better approach, if that is what this council would like to see, is support the accreditation process with the addition of an accreditation manager and be supportive of funding that over the next couple of years than an independent study. I believe we've addressed internally with key stakeholders in that process of what the department is and what it is not right now. And I thought it answered a lot of the questions, and we're working on that as a strategic plan, which you saw presented. So I would like to see the funds that would go to a study be directed to the accreditation process instead of a one-time study. I would like to see it ongoing and be sustainable over time.
Can I ask a follow-up to that?
Yeah, go ahead, follow-up.
And I would support that type of funding for the accreditation process, but I want to add a follow-up question. So does the accreditation process include, I know they're going to make sure that you're running things well from a fire protection service, but does it also look at efficiencies in terms of, I mean, you could be accredited and running things very inefficiently, I guess, is my question. So there's complementary, and I want to make sure that we're also touching on the efficiencies as well.
So I know they validate all processes that the department does, whether it be policies or practices. If you're looking for specific efficiencies, I'd need to know what you're looking for that has not been answered already. If you have something specific that you think is not efficient.
Okay.
Councilor Sear, then Councilor Pearson.
So I'm interested in the specifically in the inspections and sort of the impact overall for staffing or budget that the inspection process has for you. And then I guess I'm also, we collect fees for building inspectors, and are we able to collect through to the obligation we have for the fire department? Is that allocated? I'm not familiar with how that process works.
Well, what happens, like any budget, you have the revenue and the expenditure side of the budget. So what we do is we bring in on the revenue side inspection revenues, and of course that's built into the fee committee's program that goes forward. So that comes in, and indirectly it does help offset the tax rate. But from an expenditure side, it's not dollar for dollar, but it's spread out over the departments.
And the impact of the inspections is our deputy chief is responsible for all plans reviews from the life safety, sprinklers, and so forth. So every project requires 2 to 3 reviews. And just like the inspection department and for the city, this is not one a week that it's happening.
Right.
This is multiple. And then any existing occupancy, or when something's going to get the place of assembly or its occupancy permit, we have to go in there and make sure it's complete. And that usually takes 2 or 3 visits. So we're looking internally how to adjust the workload and start prioritizing, but other projects are starting to take a backseat, like inspections of apartment buildings and our public educational programs in the schools into the target project. So
what we can do, and what we do in the building department, is also you can, if it's a larger project, we can hire out a firm to come in to work, review the plans, and then we charge back the developer for that. Okay. So it's something that we can talk to the chief about, and so that he might be able to put on supplemental project review that would be for the larger projects. So getting back to what he said, education would for the fire marshal. So that's something we'll work on internally. I think we can work that out with them and talk about how we can push that cost back on the larger projects.
Okay, thank you.
Nancy?
Thank you, Mayor. Can you talk a little bit more about the self-assessment? How long do you think it will take between implementation of some of those changes and the ability to measure efficiencies or cost savings? When did you implement them? How long is this?
Well, I suspect that, again, that a number of them, we had a number of recommendations and an assessment of each one, so not everything needs action to resolve. But we're using this as a 3 to 5 year plan. The lower hanging fruit, we're trying to do quicker. And again, it's starting to transition to a strategic plan where the council or the public should see some report from us on a regular basis, such as we did today, is some of the things we've implemented.
Right.
It would be reasonable to say that in a 3 to 5 year period, we would have to reassess where we're at, what have we obtained. Simple things that may not be immediate measurable is just changing our replacement program of fire apparatus, like the aerial, to a 20-year cycle, not a 15-year cycle, based on the best practice that we noted in the study or the self-assessment. I can't tell you if that's going to, you know, immediately what's the cost savings going to be, but so those are things I think that we have to reassess over time to see if it's been effective.
Councilor Dwyer?
Just want to reiterate Eric's point. If we go accreditation crazy in our city, that accreditation and innovation are two entirely different things motivated by entirely different impulses. And accreditation is inherently conservative. In fact, it's been a real problem in education because it has kept things as they are instead of innovation. I think the two are parallel. So I think this discussion is good, but I don't want to conflate the two.
Thank you.
And just a little bit more on the emergency management.
Right.
And as I mentioned before, the city manager serves as the emergency management director, and I work with him as the coordinator. And it's a collaborative approach because we have a number of key city department heads and staff that participate. So the idea is, one, to plan and prepare for any man-made natural disaster. And we seek grants, and we work with the state Homeland Security and Emergency Management in our region to do that. So this is probably one of the easier budgets when all things are good, that we're looking at about $11,000 budget. There's no increase. This can go up and down based on a disaster. As you see in Alberta, they're having a large fire disaster right now that is affecting that. And a lot of times when we have a disaster, we have to fund it up front, and then we get 75% of that money back. So if that were to happen, that we'd work with the city manager on that. We do use grants and Homeland Security funds to support emergency planning, such as for the radiological emergency planning for Seabrook. We get a flat rate from the state, and we use that for any emergency planning purposes, radiological plans. seeking some grant funding to update our local emergency operating plan. So most of this money is either to front-load some salaries if it's assigned to those projects, and we try to get grant money to fill most of that back. So this is a pretty simple budget, and you know, my idea is over the course of next year that we don't have any large disasters, but I can. We are always paying attention to situation awareness with any storms or any events. And other city staff, key staff have been great in supporting emergency management.
Right, and just so that, you know, mostly it all has been, luckily, weather-related. And as the chief said, we do have an opportunity through Seabrook Station to do our emergency planning, and we do have exercises. So we actually are able to get paid to do those, and we can convert those to weather-related. It's kind of the same thing in terms of moving people around, getting shelters, and we do have a plan in place. So we work with the health department, public works, police. So there's a number of agencies that we work with, and I want to just commend the chief. He's done a nice job keeping things together. My role, and I intended to keep it that way, is to just be the person that would then authorize certain expenditures and those types of things, but leave it to the people that do it on a daily basis.
That's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. Have a great
Saturday.
Time for
a 15-minute break. Ooh.